Hello guys, welcome back. Myself Pushpender Singh, and we are going to start with our current affairs. So, as you know that today you have 5th of May 2021, and basically these lectures, which are based on the current affairs, are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis, right? And I'm referring basically the two national newspapers, the Hindu or Indian Express. You can also refer these two newspapers, and you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures also, right? And these lectures are basically very useful for those who are preparing for the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is about the virtual summit. The virtual summit between India and the United Kingdom. Okay, so virtual summit, as you know, the virtual summit is not something which is happening on, say, something on the physical proximity, but it is happening on the internet, right? So it is basically on the virtual platform, on the internet platform that is happens. Okay, now the virtual summit that is recently been happened between the Indian Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi as well as the British Prime Minister Mr. Boris Johnson, right, which have held this virtual summit recently. So in this virtual summit, both of these leaders, Narendra Modi and Boris Johnson, has basically shows the roadmap 2030, right? This roadmap 2030 was adopted during this virtual summit. Okay, this roadmap is basically provides a basically a roadmap for enhancing the bilateral ties to the comprehensive strategic partnership. That means both of these leaders have decided to enhance or to elevate the current bilateral ties to the level of comprehensive strategic partnership. That means both of these leaders are basically aspiring to become the comprehensive strategic partner, right, to each other's needed. Okay, now this roadmap, which is basically provided for the 2030 as a goal, right, that will basically paves the way for the deeper and the stronger engagement between the two nations over the next 10 years, because 2030 is not very far. It's hardly 10 years right now from today, right? And in this process of comprehensive strategic partnership, the both of these leaders basically aspiring that in that the people-to-people contacts, the trade and economy, the defense and security, as well as the climate actions, as well as the health, right, parameter should be taken, right, as a basis for enhancing the partnership between the two nations. Okay, now the two nations, apart from this, the roadmap 2030 has also, launched the enhanced trade partnership, right? This enhanced trade partnership, as you know, that will basically enhance the partnership between the two countries in terms of trade. So both of these leaders, Mr. Narendra Modi as well as Mr. Boris Johnson, both of these leaders have set the ambitious target of doubling their bilateral trade. That means they are aspiring to have, right, the double of their bilateral trade that is happening between the two countries. Okay, that is by 2030. So both of these leaders are ambitious to have this goal. Okay, now both of these leaders also agreed, right, that they would continue to have like discussions or negotiations on the comprehensive and bilateral free trade agreement, right? So that is something, the free trade agreement, that is most important in order to enhance the bilateral trade between any two nations, right? Or between the group of the nations, right? So here the both of the nations basically is considering the interim trade agreement. The interim trade agreement basically is something that by that time we finalize the free trade agreement, right, between the India and the Britain, you can have the interim trade agreement, right? So that we can have some early gains or early benefit out of it, right? And we should not be lagged behind in that terms. Okay, as you know that the UK is India's second largest partner in the research and innovation collaborations, right? That means UK is substantially contributing in terms of the research and innovations in specifically in this field, right? And in this virtual summit, both of these leaders also announce the India-UK Global Innovation Partnership, okay, as both of these leaders are basically already collaborating with each other in terms of the research and in terms of innovation. So let's take this partnership further. Let's take this partnership to the greater heights both of these leaders have announced the India-UK Global Innovation Partnership, right? And that is basically to the main aim of this global partnership, right, is to support the transfer of the inclusive Indian innovations, right, which are India specific to select developing countries like, you know, Africa, so that these countries are also getting benefited out of this India-UK Global Innovation Partnership, right, sorry, in terms of these innovations. Okay, now both of these countries, India and the UK, also launched the comprehensive partnership on the migration and the mobility, right? As you know that the comprehensive partnership on the migration and the mobility is something that is related to the migrations, right, the mobility of the people. So here this partnership would definitely bring, right, the migrations from each country, right, that means from India to Britain or from Britain to India, on either way, right, or to mobilize the human resources or to mobilize the persons, specifically the students and the professionals that will be, you know, facilitated under this agreement, right? And both sides has also agreed to enhance the cooperation on the remaining fields, right? For example, the emerging technologies, like including you can have the information and the communication technology, that is ICT products, digital products, as well as some sort of a supply chain resilience. Because now, as you know that, in terms of, if you see in the Indo-Pacific region, the China is basically a dominant player. So the supply chain resilience is most important in terms of providing the timely delivery or timely supply of those, you know, the products and the services everywhere in the world. Okay, so both of these leaders are basically have decided to to participate basically in this area also, right? And both of these leaders also decided to agreed, right, to strengthen the defense and the security ties, because that is something that is most important. Okay, so both sides have decided to cooperate in the maritime sector, in the counter-terrorism sector, in the cyberspace domains, because every country is affected because of such cyber terrorism activities, right? So all of these countries are definitely would like to have this cooperation and deeper cooperation and coordination among those countries which are also having on the same platform. And that is the most important step that both of these leaders have been taken under this virtual summit. Okay, so here you can see the Prime Minister of the Britain or United Kingdom, Mr. Joris Monson, and here you know that Mr. Narendra Modi, who is the Prime Minister of India. Fine. Let's understand 5G technology and the spectrum trials. Okay, as you know that 5G technology, okay, that is something that is prospected that will come in India, right, specifically in in telecommunications. So here the Department of Telecommunication, Government of India, has given the approval or given the permissions, right, specifically for conducting the trials for uses and the applications of 5G technology, specifically to service, you know, telecom service providers. So Department of Telecommunication have been given the approval to provide or to conduct the trials for the use and applications of this 5G technology, specifically in this on the Indian mainland, right? So let us first understand what is 5G technology, and then we'll go to that further details of the news, right, regarding what all other, you know, the permissions which are granted to the telecom service providers by the Department of Telecommunications for the use and for the purpose of trials, right? So let us understand first 5G technology. So 5G technology is basically, you can say, it's a fifth generation mobile technology, or simple fifth generation mobile network technology, right? It is a new global wireless standard, right? After probably you would have heard about the 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G, right? So it is a new, you know, wireless global standard after these four generation networks, right? So what 5G enables, a new kind of network that is designed to connect virtually everyone, right? And everything together, right? Including you can basically, you know, connect virtually even objects, devices in the machines anywhere, right? So this 5G wireless technologies mean to deliver the higher multi GPS or GBPS, that is gigabytes per second peak data speed. That means the 5G technology would provide you the enhanced speed in terms of the gigabytes per second, right? This technology will have the ultra low latency, right? This technology will have the more reliability. This technology will have the massive network capacity, so that you can connect the more devices, more data, right? it can increase the availability, and it will also the more uniform user experience to greater number of users, right? So definitely the 5G technology would definitely, you know, would provide you the higher performance and improve efficiency, right? Which will definitely empower, you know, the basically users as well as industries also. So if I go about of 1G technology, that is first generation technology. So first generation technology, that is something you have the analog voice that was implemented in India in around 1980s. That is something related to the analog voice, right? The 2G technology, the 2G technology was implementing in India in early 1990s. It was implemented and it is basically introduced the digital voice instead of analog voice. Here in 1G technology, you have basically the digital voice, right? And here you would have seen also the CDMA handsets, right? CDMA means code division multiple access. That is CDMA handsets was also there. Even some CDMA handsets are also found, okay? Then 3G or 3G, third generation technology, that was started in early 2000, right? And it is basically brought the mobile data, right? It is basically brought the mobile data technology. Next, the fourth generation, which is basically currently we are using, is a basically LTE platform, right? That we are using this LTE platform in the era of mobile broadband, right? So definitely this 1G, 2G, 3G or 4G, whatever may be the G, that is designed to provide you more connectivity, right? And more accessibility, but 5G is more unified, right? It is more capable air interface, right? It is designed to extend the capacity to enable the next generation user and user experience and empower the new deployment model as well as deliver new services to the peoples, right? So it will expand the mobile ecosystems into the new realm, right? So here, after understanding this basics of this G technology, now let us understand what are other the permissions which are given by the Department of Telecommunications to the telecom service providers. So here the telecom service providers are those providers which provide you the telecom connectivity, like the phone calls, data uses and etc. For example, you might have used the Airtel network, that is Bharti Airtel Limited, Reliance also, the Reliance Jio Infocom, and Vodafone also, Vodafone Idea. The Idea have been taken over by the Vodafone, so it is combinedly known as Vodafone Idea Limited, as well as Mahanagar Telecom Nagar Nigam Limited, that is MTNL, right? So all four have been given basically an approval or the permission to conduct the trial for the use and applications of 5G technology, but for the period of 6 months, right? So each of these telecom service providers would have to conduct the trials specifically in the rural areas and the semi-urban settings, right? So in the semi-urban settings as well in the urban settings, so that the benefits of the 5G technology can proliferate specifically across the country, and that is not something specifically to be limited to the urban areas. So objective of this conducting these 5G trials include, right, the testing, right, that 5G spectrum propagation specifically in the Indian context, right, testing, you know, some sort of a model tuning and evaluation of the equipments and the vendors that we are using or we are going to use, the testing of indigenous technology providing this 5G technology, testing of applications that support basically this 5G technology, and also most important, testing the 5G phones and the devices that will basically use this 5G networks, right? That is something most important. And as I told you that 5G basically enhance you, the, you know, expand the mobile ecosystem to the new realm. So it will be, you know, it will be providing much greater connectivity, right? It will enable, right, you know, the greater connectivity to the people. So it will have the improved user experience in terms of the data download rates. For example, the current data rates that is being provided by the 4G technology, the 5G technology will expect you to provide 10 times more download data rates, right? That is the 10 times faster, right? And that will be, you know, expected to provide the 3 times greater spectrum efficiency and ultra low latency, right? That is being provided, right, by the 4G networks. Right. So I have given you the 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G and 5G networks. So here you have only analog, or you have only analog voice 1G that I have given you. Only analog voice, so you don't have basically any sort of, you know, the digital voice that was not there. But the second generation, that was the digital voice. So you have the CDMA handsets, right? It was introduced in early 1990s. It was introduced in 1980s, right? And it has the speed up to 40 kilobytes per second kbps, right? So you can say it was introduced at that point of the time. The 3G networks, you can say that it was effectively introduced in early 2000, but it was started introducing in 1998, right? It has the speed of 21.6 megabytes per second. Okay, so this had bought the mobile data. The 4G, basically you have the speed of up to 1 gigabytes per second, right? And you have other specifications, like you have 256 and MB memory, as well as you have 16 GB storage capacity that devices may have. Okay, then fifth generation or 5G generation, that can have the speed up to 20 gigabytes per second, right? That is going to be implemented by 2018 onward, but effectively that will take some more time, say specifically 2022 or 23, and so, and that will have the memory of 8 GB and that will have storage capacity of 512 GB storage capacity. So that is some technical specification, that is something to be understood. Okay. Next, you have the Moorhen yoga mat. The Moorhen yoga mat, right? Something you must understand is basically, you can say it is basically a mat, or simply you can say that the mat is called Moorhen yoga mat, that will be basically produced from, a water hyacinth. The water hyacinth is basically an aquatic plant. So yoga mat, that is something would be, eatable. That means you can have or you can eat that mat, right? That is basically produced out of the water hyacinth. You might have seen on the water bodies that certain aquatic plants basically covered, right, the surface of the water. That one species is called water hyacinths. And here the six girls, basically the six girls belongs to the fishing community in the Assam, have turned this water hyacinths into the compostable yoga or biodegradable yoga mat that will be developed, right? So here that yoga mat will be available, right? And that will be used, right, for the purpose of, different applications. So here, the biodegradable and compostable yoga mat, which is developed by the girls, sorry, it is not eatable. It is basically for the purpose of various applications, right? So this water hyacinths, what is water hyacinth? Water hyacinth is basically the free floating perennial aquatic plant. So here, I'm talking about this water hyacinth. It is basically the free floating perennial aquatic plant. What is perennial? Perennial means throughout the year, right? Throughout the year. So it is freely floating, right? Without any support. The perennial aquatic plant, that means it is only found in the aquatic region, right? Or you can also say that it is also the hydrophyte. The hydrophyte, right? Now, it is native to the tropical and subtropical South America, as well as it is also found in certain pockets of India, but it is native to the tropical and subtropical regions of Southern America. And it has basically broad, thick and glossy leaves, that is basically you can easily find out, right, if the water that is basically there. And these water hyacinths basically may rise above the surface of the water also, probably up to 1 meter or up to 3 feet, right, in the height. So you can easily identify this water hyacinths. And now the girls from the fishing community in the Assam have converted this water hyacinths into the biodegradable and composable yoga mat, right? And this composable and biodegradable yoga mat will soon be available in the market for various purposes, right? So now, since we were considering this water hyacinths as not good for the aquatic life, right, it is now being converting a boon for specifically for the fishing community, which can now enable to convert this water hyacinths into a yoga mat that will basically provide a much needed avenue for generating the income to those fishing communities. So here the intervention was triggered through the initiative by the Northeast Center for Technology Applications and the REACH, that is called NECTAR. So NECTAR is basically an autonomous body under Department of Science and Technology, right? Here the NECTAR is involved in involving the cooperation of the girls, specifically the women community, right, which is basically associated with this converting of this water hyacinths into, right, the compostable and biodegradable yoga mat, right, that collectively called Simang, that means a dream, right? So here the six girls have converted this water hyacinths into the biodegradable and compostable yoga mat that will be have the different applications to create the wealth from the water, right? So here, right, the wealth can be created, wealth in terms of the financial avenues or the financial opportunities will be available to those women community or women fishing members who are basically working with those fishing communities also, right? All right. Next, the used cooking oil, that is in the short, you can say UCO based biodiesel. As you know that biodiesel is, you know, having the greater applicability or greater applications in terms of, you know, reduction in terms of your the greenhouse gases, as well as reduction in terms of your the crude oil, as well as your the petrol and the diesel's consumption in the world, right? So biodiesel have the greater applications in terms of the reduction of your greenhouse gases like methane, carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, right? So now the Union Minister for the Petroleum and the Natural Gas basically have flagged off the first supply of used cooking oil based biodiesel. So here the used cooking oil, that is something that we used that oil, right? And based on that used cooking oil, you basically make it to biodiesel, right? Then biodiesel will be blended to the diesel that will basically reduce the consumption of ultimately diesel, as well as it will also enhance the efficiency as well as, right, you know, the quality of the diesel, as well as it will also reduce the consumption of the diesel. So here the used cooking oil would be first of all would be converted into the biodiesel, and then biodiesel will be, you know, blended with the diesel under, you know, the expression of interest scheme that is being invited by the government of India or by the Ministry of Petroleum and the Natural Gas for the purpose of specifically, you know, generating of this biodiesel that will be ultimately blended in the diesel from the India's oil, the Tikri Kalam terminal, New Delhi. Right, you got it that point. So used cooking oil will be used, right, for the purpose of the biodiesel that will be ultimately blended with the diesel to reduce the consumption of the diesel, as well as to increase the efficiency, right, as well as to reduce the consumption of diesel, because this conventional natural resources that we are using is basically have some limitations of their use. They are going to be exhausted in the future, right? So here to create an ecosystem for the collection and the conversion, right, that the used cooking oil, right, which is generally being, you know, discarded, right, by the use, right, after use. So that will be first of all converted, right, to the biodiesel. So that will have the greater applications. So here you need a basically ecosystem first of all to collect that used cooking oil, and then you need a proper infrastructure to convert that used cooking oil into a biodiesel, right? So for the purpose, the minister of, or simply the Union Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas have initiated the expression of interest, or EOI, right, for the purpose of this procurement of this biodiesel produced from cooking oil, right, on the occasion of the World Biofuel Day on 10th of August 2019. Okay, so for the purpose, the India has been flagging off this this biofuel, right, which will be ultimately used, right, as a fuel for running the vessels or for running the vehicles, right? So here the oil marketing companies would periodically incremental price guarantee for the 5 years, right, and that will be extend to take off guarantee for the 10 years for the basically prospective entrepreneurs under this scheme, right? So here the under this initiative, the Indian Oil have received the 51 kiloliters of, you know, the used, you know, the cooking oil biodiesel at the Tikri Kalan terminal in Delhi as of 31st March 2021, right? So under this scheme, already we have received, right, this used cooking oil for the purpose of, you know, making into the biodiesel, and then ultimately it will be blended into the diesel. So it will be a landmark achievement in terms of the India's pursuit of having the biofuels, right, as a biodiesel. So biodiesel is one form of the biofuel that will be basically useful for the purpose of, you know, blending in terms of diesel, and that will have the positive impact on the environment over the period of time. Okay, next you have the Swamitva. See, Swamitva is basically a scheme. So here The Union Minister of Panchayati Raj, Sri Narendra Singh Tomar, have released the new framework for the implementation of the Swamitv scheme. So first of all, this Swamitv scheme was basically implemented as a pilot project in 9 states. After being successfully implemented in these 9 states, right, Sri Narendra Singh Tomar, who is also the Union Minister for the Panchayati Raj, have basically, you know, have marked this national wise roll down of this scheme. So now, after successfully implementing this pilot project, this Swamitv scheme now successfully will be rolled in basically throughout the country. So it will be implemented throughout the country after being successfully implemented, right? So Swamitv framework is basically developed by the Ministry of Panchayati Raj, which is a nodal ministry for that purpose. So let us understand what is Swamitv framework. So Swamitv, the full form is the survey of villages and mapping with the improvised technology in village areas. Okay, it is the full form of the Swamitv. So Swamitv is basically the survey of villages and mapping with the improvised technology in the village area. So it is basically a scheme, as you know, is a new initiative which was started by the Ministry of Panchayati Raj, right, on the occasion of the Panchayati Raj Day on 24th of April. Okay, the main aim of the Swamitv scheme is to provide the rural people, right, with a right to document their residential properties, okay, so that they can use their property into economic purpose. It can be converted into financial asset, right? So here in this scheme, right, there will be a surveying for the land parcels, specifically in these rural areas, where the rural inhabited areas, the drone technology will be used for the purpose of survey. And this survey will be done across the country, but definitely in the phased manner, right, over the period of 5 years, say from 2020 to 2025. And it is basically a central sector scheme, right, that will have some outlay of around 79.65 crore, right? That was basically for the pilot phase that was implemented from 2020 to 2021. Now it will be rolled out throughout the country after successfully implementing this pilot project. So, right, so it will provide a detailed roadmap and the guidelines, right, for various states in terms of the scheme's objective, right, in terms of the coverage, in terms of components, in terms of the year-wise funding that will be provided, right, the survey approach that will be used, the methodology that will be used, the stakeholders that have to be incorporated, their roles and the responsibilities, as well as the monitoring and evaluations, as well as the deliverables that is expected from the Swamitv scheme under this initiative. Okay, regarding the Swamitv, as I told you that it is a central sector scheme that is implemented by the Ministry of Panchayati Raj. The full form, I have told you, the Swamitv is basically the survey of villages and the mapping with improvised technology in the village areas. It is basically, you know, a nationally launched scheme, definitely on the occasion of the National Panchayati Raj Day on 24th of April 2021, right? After definitely being successfully implemented in a pilot project, right, in a 9 states, okay? So it will provide, you know, some sort of property rights to the residents of the rural areas or rural inhabited areas. Definitely, we will use the enhanced technology like drone survey, right, as well as the COS network that will provide the accuracy up to 5 centimeters that can basically reduce any sort of a conflict, and that property right will be used as a financial assets for getting, you know, any other financial benefits from the government of India or from the banking system, right? So here the Ministry of Panchayati Raj is basically nodal agency for the implementation of this Swamitv scheme, right? In the state level, the revenue department or the land record department will be a nodal department, or that will be carried out any such support activities with the basically support of the state Panchayati Raj departments under the states. All right, so here you can see the drone basically which is conducting the survey over the land, and it will be used a technology that will be providing under this Swamitv scheme. All right, next. The next is something that is CCMB LACONS. What is CCMB? CCMB is something, the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, right? That is CCMB. What is LACONS? LACONS, you must understand, it is a laboratory for the conservation for endangered species. Okay, so here you can understand it is a combined name that has been given, right? So here the report which is published by the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, right, the laboratory for conservation of the endangered species, right, have published a report that this report says that a very disturbing trend that the 8 Asiatic lions that has been housed in the Nehru Zoological Park in the Hyderabad have tested positive for the SARS-CoV-2 virus. That is very disturbing, the outcome or the report, that is the lions have tested positive for the SARS-CoV-2 virus. So after humans, even the animals are also having infected with the coronavirus. That is something very disturbing, right? So the LACONS, which is basically, a laboratory for the conservation of the endangered species, is basically a laboratory under the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. It is located in Hyderabad, right? It is a part of the Center for Cellular and the Molecular Biology. That means the laboratory called LACONS, which is with the Council of Scientific and the Industrial Research, is a part of the Center for Cellular and the Molecular Biology. Now, what is this Center for Cellular and the Molecular Biology? That is something to be understood. So, Center for Cellular and the Molecular Biology is basically the Indian Fundamental Science Research Establishment, right? It is located at Hyderabad, okay? And that basically operates under the aegis of CSIR, or simple, the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, all right? So, now, this center was basically conceptualized by the Lalji Singh, right? And it is India's only research facility that is basically engaged in the conservation and the preservation of the wildlife, specifically in the endangered species, right? And the lab is basically strive to promote the excellence in the conservation biotechnology as well as to serve for the conservation of the endangered wildlife throughout the country, right? As the name itself suggests, it is, right, is itself is basically the laboratory for the conservation of endangered species. Ultimate motto is to conserve the endangered species throughout the world, and it was basically established in 1998 with the help of the Central Zoo Authority of India, along with the collaboration with the CSIR, that is Council for the Scientific and Industrial Research, as well as with the help of the Government of India, Government of Andhra Pradesh, right? It has been dedicated to the nation 2007, right, by our great president of India, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, all right. So here you can see the Asiatic lions which have been infected with the SARS-CoV-2 virus. It is very disturbing trend. Okay, next, the production linked incentive scheme for the IT hardware. So here you must understand, the IT hardware is something to be understood in terms of your computers, in terms of your laptops, in terms of your tablets, in terms of servers. So IT hardware is something that you can touch, you can feel, but software you cannot touch it. Can you touch the software that you're looking at your screen on your PC or your laptop? You cannot touch it. You can just simply feel it, but the hardware you can touch it. For example, the mouse, the computer, right, your basically the touchpad, right, your application, you can touch it, you can observe it, right? That is something is called hardware, right? So here the production linked incentive scheme was launched basically for the purpose of the boosting of the manufacturing capacity in India, specifically for the purpose of the hardware include the tablets, laptops, personal computers, right, the servers which are associated with the hardware, right? So here the production linked incentive scheme, that means if you produce more, you will be incentivized for the purpose of your production. Ultimate purpose, right, is to boost the production of the hardware from India. So as total of 19 companies have been filed an application under this production linked incentive scheme, that is for the IT hardware, to get the incentivized from the government of India. So that scheme was basically launched, or that was notified on 3rd March 2021 by the government of India, right? It will provide an incentive of around 4% to 2%. Right, or even 1% on the net incremental sales, right? That is something that is the base year have been notified by the government of India under the scheme, that is financial year 2019-20. So that will be base year. So if you have the net incremental sales over and above this base year, you will be incentivized of 4% to 1% basically based on your net incremental sales. So under, you have some sort of a target segments that are manufactured in India, right? That is something is most important. So that IT hardware, that is something manufactured in India, and that will be applicable for the period of 4 years, say for financial year 2021-22 to 2024-25. That means in that period, whatever the IT hardwares have been manufactured in India over and above the base year from 2019 and 20, that will be incentivized, right, from 4% to 1% based on their net incremental sales, right? So here the target of IT hardware segments, as I told you, that the laptops, tablets, personal computers, servers which are associated with the IT hardware, right? And here, you know, some sort of incentivize is to provide to boost the domestic manufacturing and attract the larger investments in terms of FDI, in terms of other investment in India, in terms of value chain to those IT hardware products. All right. So here you can see here, right? The person who is looking at the basically a tablet, right? It is basically a hardware, right? But the inside screen, that is something you cannot touch, but you can feel that is something is software. Okay. Next you have the Wincov 19. The Wincov 19 is a drug that has been recently been developed by the CSIR, the Center for Cellular and the Molecular Biology. Okay. So the CSIR or the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology have developed a drug that is called Wincov 19. That is the possible drug that will be treat the COVID-19, you know, affected patients, right? So it will provide certain therapeutic, you know, antibodies in the in the person who are infected with the SARS-CoV-2 virus. Okay, so Drug Controller General of India has provided the approval for the human trials for this Wincov-19 drug that will be you know, for the phase 1 and phase 2 trial of this drug that will be expected to be, you know, to be done in Delhi and the Rajasthan, right, for the purpose of this phase 1 and phase 2 trials. Okay, and it is being developed by the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, right, under CSIR, as well as with the help of the University of Hyderabad, as well as the Win Bio Products Limited, right. These agencies are involved in the development of this Wincov, which is basically, developed after a collection of the antibodies from the horses. After these horses got infected in the inactivated coronavirus, and they have collected, you know, their antibodies, right? And then from there, the drug is basically developed over the period of the time, right? So here, regarding the Center for Cellular Molecular Biology, I have already given you this information. The University of Hyderabad is basically a university located in Hyderabad. And regarding Wins Bioproduct Limited, the Wins Bioproduct Limited is basically also located in Hyderabad. It is basically committed to manufacture, to market some sort of a standard anti-sera products to its customers as well as to the worldwide according to the World Health Organization standard, right? So once this phase 1 and phase 2 trial of the Wincov-19 would be available, right, it can be approved for the emergency use definitely by India's drug regulator, right? But for that, we need basically, you know, the results of the phase 1 and phase 2 trial of this drug, right? So it will be the first specific drug for the COVID treatment that will be provided to the early age infections, specifically to the people who are infected with the SARS-CoV-2 virus. Okay. Next, you have basically the PMGKY third, that is the third such extension, right? Or the third such, you know, the extension which have been implemented for the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Anna Yojana, right? That is something you must understand with the Pradhan Mantri GKAY, that is Garib Kalyan Anna Yojana, right? So here, the third such extension under the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Anna Yojana have been, you know, announced by the government of India for the purpose of 28 states and the union territories that will started lifting these food grains from the Food Corporation of India under this third phase of the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Anna Yojana. So that is the third phase that has been announced by the government of India. So first of all, you must understand 2-3 things here. What is the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Anna Yojana? That is something you must understand. So Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Anna Yojana is a food security welfare scheme. Right, it's a simply food security welfare scheme which was announced by the government of India. It was announced in March 2020, very recently, last year only, definitely during the COVID-19 pandemic, right? So this program is sponsored by or operated by the Department of Food and Public Distribution, definitely under Ministry of Consumer Affairs, Food and Public Distribution under Government of India. So that is something, the food security welfare scheme. So under this program, right, under this Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Anna Yojana, right, the Department of Food and Public Distribution has started implementing of this program. So under this, right, for the 2 months, May and June 2021, right? That is something that is a hardship that has been imposed, right, by the COVID-19 pandemic, as well as the lockdowns or the restrictions which are imposed, right, in some state, right, to control and to tame, you know, the COVID-19 infections in India, right? The hardships would definitely been, faced by the poor as well as the, to the worker community. Specifically, they need the food grains, right, for the purpose of their survival, right? Because of such lockdowns, they cannot go for the work, they cannot earn anything. So for that, they need basically these food grains. So for the purpose of this, the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Ann Yojana would provide for these 2 months, May and the June, some sort of assistance in terms of the food grains to those poor people, to those needy people, in terms of the providing of the food grain facility, right, to those people under this Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Ann Yojana. And 28 states and union territory have already started lifting of these food grains for the purpose of distribution under this scheme, right? So Food Corporation of India, you know that Food Corporation of India is basically a statutory body which is definitely under the government of India. It is currently under the ownership of the Ministry of Consumer Affairs, Food and Public Distribution, right? Its main purpose is to collect the food grains and to allow the distribution of the food grains as and when the government require. Okay. So the government of India has announced that it will bear entire cost of implementation of the Pradhan Mantri, Garib Kalyan Ann Yojana, right, for the purpose of May-June 2021. So only for these 2 months, right, the distribution of the food grains under this Pradhan Mantri Garib Krishi, Pradhan Mantri Garib, Kalyan Ann Yojana, the government of India will bear the entire cost, and the state does not have to bear any cost, right, from this scheme, right? So that means the state government need not share their contribution under this scheme for the purpose of these 2 months. So here about 80 crores, right, this the National Food Security Act beneficiaries, right, have been covered under this scheme. So under this category, the two categories of those beneficiaries, say Antyodaya Ann Yojana as well as the priority households, that will be covered. So that is around 80 crores of such beneficiary will be covered, and that will be provided some additional quota of free of cost food grains, that is rice and the wheat at the scale of 5 kg per person per month. So that is additional 5 kg per person per month that will be provided over and above their regular monthly entitlement, right? So that will be some sort of a assistance that will be provided to those people. Next, the Common Yoga Protocol. So Common Yoga Protocol is basically being announced at the heart of the International Day of Yoga that is being observed, right? So here the Common Yoga Protocol is basically a sequence of the yogasanas of the 45 minutes duration, right? Here it is developed by some of the most renowned yoga gurus, right, in 2015, and that yoga protocol would have to be provided under this International Day of Yoga observation, right, for the purpose of the sequence of the yogasana that can be done by the people or the citizens for the purpose of their yoga exercise for 45 minutes duration. Okay, so it is designed basically for the learning by the common people. They can easily learn, right, irrespective of their age, irrespective of their gender, right? So it is equally applicable, universally applicable to every section, right, irrespective of this age. That means from the children to the old age people, they can do so, and the men and women can equally do such yogasanas, right? And that too, they can be learned such simple training sessions through the online classes also, right? So here, Common Yoga Protocol, that is the best introductory programs specifically for the beginners to learn this yoga, specifically from the trained yoga gurus, right? So that's all. Thank you very much for attending this session. Take care of yourself, and definitely we'll meet tomorrow for our next current affairs. Till then, enjoy. Thank you very much.